JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFT's daily market review for August the 12th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFT, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar traded higher against all the other G10 currencies on Tuesday and during the Asian morning Wednesday. It gained the most versus the Kiwi, the Aussie and the Yen in that order, while it decked out the least gains against the Canadian dollar. The strengthening of the US dollar combined with the weakening of the risk-linked Aussie and Kiwi suggests that trading turned risk-off at some point yesterday. That said, bearing in mind that the safe haven yen was among the main losers as well, we will turn our gaze to the equity world in order to get a clearer picture with regards to the broader investor morale. Here, major EU indices were a sea of green, boosted by the better than expected ZEW economic sentiment index for August, as well as by remarks from Russian President Vladimir Putin, who claimed that his nation has become the first country in the world to grant regulatory approval to a coronavirus vaccine. That said, sentiment took a 118 degree spin during the US session, with Wall Street's main indices falling on average 0.96%. The reversal may have come as the deadlock between the White House and Congress over a coronavirus aid package continued for a fourth day, with Trump's orders seen not as helpful as a potential congressional deal. Equities and risk-linked assets may continue correcting lower for a while more, but anything pointing to approaching common ground in the days ahead could be a viable reason for investors to re-increase their risk exposures. The risk aversion rolled over into the Asian session today as well. Although Japan's Nikkei gained 0.34%, China's Shanghai Composite and Hong Kong's Hang Seng are currently down 1.66% and 0.14% respectively. Now back to the currencies. Apart from the switch in the broader market sentiment, the Kiwi was also beaten by the overnight monetary policy decision of the RBNZ. The bank decided to keep its official cash rate unchanged at 0.25%, but expanded its large-scale asset purchase program up to 100 billion New Zealand dollars from 60 billion New Zealand dollars, adding that a package of additional monetary instruments must remain in active preparation, including a negative interest rate and purchases of foreign assets. Although they acknowledged that New Zealand had contained the spread of the coronavirus locally, they noted that the global economic disruption caused by the pandemic is persisting, and that's why there remains a downside risk to their baseline economic scenario. The Kiwi slid around 40 pips against the greenback at the time of the announcement, while the clear prospect of negative interest rates may keep it underselling interest for a while more. However, the broader direction of the risk-linked currency is likely to stay dependent on developments surrounding the broader market sentiment. Even if we see some further declines in the short run, a potential agreement between the White House and Congress in the US over a coronavirus aid bill may be a decent reason for another reversal to the upside. Now, as for tonight, during the Asian morning Thursday, Australia's employment report for July is coming out. The unemployment rate is forecast to have risen to 7.8% from 7.4%, while the net change in employment is anticipated to show that the economy has added 40,000 jobs after gaining 210,800 in June. At last week's gathering, the RBA kept its targets for the cash rate and the yield on three-year government bonds unchanged at 0.25%, noting that the bank's mid-March package of support is working as expected. What's more, officials noted that even though the worst in this contraction has now passed, the outlook remains highly uncertain and that the recovery will be dependent on the containment of the virus. With the bank also noting that in its baseline scenario, the unemployment rate is likely to rise to around 10% later this year, we don't expect the rise to 7.8% to come as a surprise to policymakers. Thus, we don't expect this report to prove a game changer with regards to the RBA's plans. Similarly with the Kiwi, even if the Aussie slides somewhat on a weaker report, the main driver for this currency is also likely to be in developments surrounding the broader investor morale. Any positive headlines over a potential accord in the US over a new fiscal package may invite buyers of this risk-linked currency back into the action. Now, as for the rest of today's events, ahead of the EU Open, we already got the first estimate of the UK GDP for the second quarter, as well as the nation's industrial and manufacturing production rates for June. Economic activity in the UK tumbled 20.4%, which is marginally better than the minus 20.9% forecast, something that took the year-over-year rate down to minus 21.7% from minus 1.7%. Both the industrial and manufacturing production rates increased to 9.3 and 11% from 6.2 and 8.3% respectively. At last week's gathering, the Bank of England kept its policy unchanged, and although it highlighted that the economic outlook remains uncertain, it upgraded its GDP forecast for this year, but with the condition that the direct impact of the pandemic on the economy will dissipate gradually over the forecast period. In the quarterly monetary policy report, officials discussed the effectiveness of negative interest rates and noted that they will continue to monitor their appropriateness. That said, we don't expect the contraction in GDP to increase speculation that the bank could adopt negative rates soon. After all, officials kept policy unchanged last week after noting that economic activity is likely to fall more than 20% in the second quarter. We prefer to pay more attention to data regarding the third quarter before we start examining whether officials will consider negative rates at some point in the foreseeable future. Now, from Sweden, we have the CPIs for July. Both the CPI and CPIF rates are expected to have declined to 0.5% year-over-year and 0.4% year-over-year respectively, after both sitting at 0.7% in June. That said, as it is always the case, we prefer to pay more attention to the core CPIF metric, which excludes the volatile items of energy. That rate stood at 1.3% in June. At its latest gathering, the Riksbank decided to extend its framework for its asset purchases from 300 billion SEK to 500 billion SEK, up to the end of June 2021, while it announced that in September it will start purchasing corporate bonds. The board also decided to cut interest rates and extend maturities on lending to banks, despite keeping the repo rate unchanged at 0%. We believe that a potential slowdown in core inflation is unlikely to prompt additional action at the bank's upcoming gathering, but it may keep officials willing to do so if the situation continues to worsen. From the Eurozone, we get industrial production data for June. Expectations are for a small slowdown to 10% from 12.4%. However, this would still be a decent monthly rate, as it would drive the year-over-year rate up to minus 11.6% from minus 20.9%. Later in the day, the US CPIs for July are coming out. The headline rate is anticipated to have increased to 0.8% year-over-year from 0.6%, while the core one is expected to have held steady at 1.2% year-over-year. Although this could lessen somewhat the probability for the Fed to expand its stimulative efforts, all the attention in the US is likely to stay on whether the Congress can eventually reach consensus on a coronavirus aid package. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.